spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us.
Well, let's open our Bibles to Philippians chapter 2, and we'll begin reading in verse 1. Typically not a Christmas passage, but it talks about Christ coming and humbling himself and joining the human race, and the impact that that should have on our lives today. If there be any comfort in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And of course, Jesus fulfilled the concept in verse 4 perfectly. Verse 6, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. And I might just say that what Paul is saying is that Jesus Christ had every right to stay in heaven. Nobody had a right to say, Jesus, come out of heaven and come to earth. He had every right to stay there. It was not robbery for him to be equal with God, but he made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore, God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's pause for prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for your love that you demonstrated towards us in sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to become one of us. We just read that that was a very humbling experience for God the Son to join us. But he did it because he put our interest ahead of his own. We thank you for that. We thank you that he submitted himself to paying the price that we could never pay ourselves. And he was willing to go to the cross and fulfill the Father's will in paying for our sin. We thank you that the Father was pleased with that and therefore highly exalted him. We look forward to the day when all things in heaven and earth and all people will recognize that Jesus Christ is indeed the King, that he indeed is the Son of God. And so we just pray that as we look forward to that day, we would understand the urgency and the importance of recognizing who Jesus Christ is before the whole universe will understand that. And so we thank you for your word. We want to thank you for our country, the freedoms that we enjoy to come together like this and open our Bibles without fear. We thank you for that. And we just commit our nation to you and the leaders to you, that perhaps even during this season, some will realize that this country was indeed founded with the idea that men are free and that we are free to worship, to choose as we please. And so we pray that as responsible citizens, we would choose the right thing, that we would recognize that true freedom comes from Jesus Christ himself, that it's the truth that will indeed set people free. And so we pray that we would have a special loyalty, a special desire to study your truth. And so we just pray that for not only us here this morning, but for all of your children around the world. We thank you for them, and we just pray that especially for those who are being persecuted, that your grace would just uphold them, and that through those trials and tribulations that others are going through, that we in this country know little of, that people could be encouraged to consider the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we thank you for this season, the time to be reminded. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, let's stand and greet one another, and we'll continue in just a moment. Thank you. Well, good morning again, and let's open our Bibles this morning to the book of Galatians. The book of Galatians. And again, a passage of Scripture that is typically not read at Christmas time, but when we look at it, I think we'll agree that the Apostle Paul is giving us a Christmas story. And in preparing for this, I ran across, some of you from your literature days might remember a guy named Rudyard Kipling, an Englishman. He was born in India, not a Christian. In fact, he was rather liberal, but he was an author and a poet and a journalist. And one of his poems, entitled The Elephant's Child, elephant comes from India, and a lot of Indian things influenced him. But the opening lines was this: I kept six honest serving men. They taught me all I know. Their names are what, why, and when, and how, and where, and who. And as we stop and we think of that, many of you know that that really is the basis for journalism. And so what I would like to do is take a journalistic analysis of the first coming of Jesus Christ. And we will ask and go through those particular questions. So turn with me, if you would, to Galatians chapter 4. And it's interesting that the Apostle Paul has, in this passage right here, has taken the time to explain to Galatian Christians how not being under the law and how being under grace, how it works, and how we are responsible adults. And so he goes through that, and he gives an illustration in verse 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Now, as we stop and we think of the cultural context that this was written in, cultures at that particular time had traditions of when do you turn into a responsible adult. Now, in our country, it used to be 21, and now it's 18. And there's even some people that want to make it 16. I don't know about you, but I think there's more and more irresponsible adults that are a lot older than 21 running around today than ever before, but that's another story. At the time of Paul, who wrote this, the Jews had their custom. And it was at 12 years old that they would do their bar mitzvah things and all of this, and they would declare their sons of the law at age 12. And they would be held responsible in many ways. But this was their tradition. The Greeks were a little different. The Greeks were, if I remember correctly, they had an age of 18. And at age 18, you were considered to be a son. Before that age, you were just a child, and you were treated legally just like any servant. The Romans actually had a little different system, which makes a lot of sense if you think about it. They didn't have a specific age. They left it up to the father to decide when the son was mature enough to take on the responsibilities of adulthood. And I think that this is probably what Paul had in mind when he wrote this. And he says in verse 1 again, and having that little cultural background, I hope verse 1 makes a little bit more sense. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father. So in Roman culture, your little five-year-old, your little six-year-old could not make decisions for themselves. They had teachers, tutors, babysitters, governors, however you want to put it, that took care of those children and made decisions for them. But when they became of age, until the time appointed of the father. And so the father, and by the way, this requires a little bit of responsibility from the fathers. And there was breakdown in family homes at that time, as well as there are today, much failure. But part of the father's responsibility was to get involved with his children and to understand and watch them mature and then give them their responsibilities as they were able to handle it. Of course, part of that was to teach them what those responsibilities are. But the point that Paul is making is that there is a time appointed by the Father. And I just might remind you that he is going to apply this to Jesus Christ and his Father. I don't believe there's anything that takes place just random. When Jesus Christ did things and God the Father did things, there was order to it. And there was a time for it. And so the Apostle Paul, in applying this to us, says, even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. And the idea of elements there was the law that he makes reference to in other passages. And as a child, you didn't make your own decisions. And there was a time when all of us were under the law. And then he says this, but, verse 4, when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law. And so as we go through the when, what, why, where's, and of this particular passage, he starts off with when this took place. And he tells us in the fullness of time. And as I've mentioned, there isn't a date that is established with this. Roman law said fathers decide when that time comes. And we look at the time and we said, why was Jesus Christ born when he was? And not a mistake. God knows exactly what he's doing. And he sent his son at the right time. And if some of your translations, instead of fullness of time, have the right time or the appointed time, it's all good. That's the idea. At just the right time, the script we have God sending his son. Well, let's look at the culture of the time. And I've listed about five things right here. One of the things that's interesting at this time is that the Old Testament, the Scriptures, as it was called. Now, keep in mind, in Jesus' day, they didn't have an Old Testament and a New Testament because they didn't have a New Testament yet. That hadn't been written yet. In fact, it's referred to as just simply the Scripture. And it included the Old Testament at that time. And the Old Testament had been written over a number of years, and it was completed about 400 years before Christ, but it was still in kind of segmented. And during the 400, what we call the silent years, between the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the birth of Christ, the Jewish people, I don't know if it was through all of their being kicked out of their country and all the exiles that they went through. But there was a general aversion towards paganism and worshiping idols. And during this time, the Old Testament was written in Greek. We call that the Septuagint. And what's interesting is that this Greek Old Testament could now be read throughout the Roman world. And we'll get to that point in just a minute. And with all of this put together, there was no excuse for people not to look into the Old Testament and see all the prophecies concerning the Messiah when he came. So God gave them the record. And you could tell when he was going to be born, how he was going to be born, where he was going to be born, and the purpose for what he was born. All was laid out in the Old Testament. It's really interesting when Paul says of sinners that we are without excuse. Wow, this is really comes to light. And you might ask, and maybe I should have put this one first, but it was Alexander the Great who had brought a common language to the whole world. And while people spoke their own languages, the language was, in fact, it was called Koine Greek. Some of you may have heard that word, Koine. It means common. And wherever Alexander the Great went, he brought his language, and he literally forced it and made it the official language, and it caught on. And that is interesting as we stop and we think of a common language. Some of you know that here a month or so ago, we visited Germany, and they have a lot of different dialects in Germany. In fact, they're telling me some places Germans can't understand their fellow Germans because they just speak a different dialect and they don't get it. But it's interesting that I don't care if you're in Munich or in Berlin, English is always present. And in fact, one night we had eaten out in downtown Munich where people walked a lot, and the big city square, and there's people all over the place. And here's a rock and roll band. And there's a group of people around the stage. You can all picture it. You could have been in the United States. You couldn't tell the difference. And guess what language they were singing in? English. Really? And everywhere you went, you could find somebody who could speak English. And it wasn't that easy to tell you the truth, but be that as it may, waiters in restaurants, they all could speak English. Well, the German people want their children to learn English. And what's interesting, they want them to learn American English, not English English. So that's kind of interesting. By the way, that's how my daughter got her job as a nanny in Germany. This family wanted their children to learn American English. And it's interesting, in Germany, you can't go there and get a job. You have to have somebody tell you that, or explain to the government that you are not replacing a German's job. Well, American English, that's it. And so that's kind of a little different thing. And by the way, they do want you to learn German. And for her to keep renewing her visa, she has to take a test in German language and culture to be assimilated. And they have problems with refugees refusing to assimilate. And they are not happy about it. And I thought, wow. I thought the Europeans were supposed to be following them. I wish we were in many ways, but that's another story. But let's go on. Alexander the Great brought a common language, and as you put this together, this is kind of interesting. Well, after the Greek Empire fell, They were taken over by the Romans. And the Romans brought about, in fact, what's Julius Caesar, about 150 BC or something like that. And prior to that, they fought what the Tunic or Punic or whatever it is, wars. And finally they won and there was peace. And there was about 200 years of no war because the Romans conquered, and they call that period the Pax Romana. Some of you might remember that from your ancient history classes sometime. A period of peace. And we look on, and we also find out that during this time, the Romans had built a freeway system. Well, not like us, but the Roman roads. And there was cities and countries that they had conquered that were connected by roads. But that's not all. They also established a mail system. I was going to put the post office here, but they didn't call them post offices in those days. But they had a mail system. And you stop and you think about that. Wow, you mean the Apostle Paul could write a letter and he mailed it to the churches in different countries. And that wouldn't have been possible except for, and I'm not advocating the Romans, they're very cruel and in many ways, but I'll tell you what, they enforced the peace. And you better get in line and follow their system. But they had a system. And isn't it interesting that when the time was right, God sent his son into a world that had the scripture available to them, written not in Hebrew, but also in Greek. They had a system in place where people could communicate. They had a system in place where you could travel, and you could travel in many ways without fear, and you also could mail epistles. And God the Father said this, you know what? This is the time that I'm going to send my son into the world. And so in looking at the rules of journalism, and just a little side note, I wish journalists today would kind of follow those rules, but I guess they have their own rules they've made up in the meantime and forgot just the facts of the case. So he tells us when. He also tells us who is involved. That's important. And so as we look at this, we read this. God sent forth his son. Now there's two people involved here. The who involved is God the Father and God the Son. Those are the people that are involved. By the way, people had nothing to do with the timing or the sending of God's Son. So who are we looking at here? We're looking at God the Father and God the Son. That's the who in this particular story. Well, let's go on. The what? Well, what do you mean by that? What did God do? And if you're writing the story, it's not enough just to say when it happened, who was involved, but what did they do? And so what we find is this: God sent forth his son. And the last slide, I had God underlined and son underlined. That's the who. But now he sent forth. And as we think of the word sent forth, that's an interesting term because it means to be commissioned. God the Father commissioned his son. This is official business. Sent forth in the scripture at this particular time wasn't just you telling your kid or me telling, hey, as long as you're in the kitchen, get me a, could you bring me a napkin? Brenda, does that sound like me? Okay. Or, when you get up, bring me a little cream for my coffee, something like that. When you were sent forth at this particular time, it was on official business. You were sanctioned. You were given accreditation. And when you carried the message, people better listen to you because this message came from the authority that sent you. And so God the Father commissioned his Son, God the Son, to go forth. And so as we stop and we think of what God the Father did, he commissioned his Son, and that raises our next question. Where? Where did all this take place? God sent forth his Son from where to where? And if you read a story in the newspaper, could you imagine a reporter saying, oh, there was an accident and three people got hurt? Where did that happen? I can hear some of you saying that. Well, who's involved? Whose fault was it? Et cetera, et cetera. What happened? And so we look at this, and from where to where? And the answer is from heaven to earth. We kind of read that this morning in Philippians chapter 2, that God sent his Son. Why? He humbled him. God, Jesus Christ, had every right to stay in heaven, but he left heaven's glory and humbled himself and came to earth. And so John 1, and let's just turn back there to these, and don't worry. I can smell dinner burning. No, I can smell dinner cooking, and we won't let it burn, so we'll work quickly. John 1, 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shined in darkness. And it's interesting that in this passage, the word is changed to him. Jesus Christ is the Word, and he was with God, and he was God. If you jump over to verse 14, and the Word was made flesh. Really? Well, that means the Word must be Jesus Christ, and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten Father, full of grace and truth. And so, what is going on here? Hebrews 10, and in Hebrews 10, we've got an interesting passage. In fact, I almost read this passage for our scripture reading this morning, but in Hebrews 10, and I'll pick it up in verse 5, right after he explains that, and I'll read it, verse 1. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect or complete. For then would they not have ceased to be offered. In other words, you could stop offering because the worshipers once purged should have no more conscience of sins. But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sin. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. And burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. And Jesus Christ was given a human body. I might just say that What that does is that makes Jesus Christ the perfect mediator between God and man. A mediator needs to represent both parties, and they need to be equal with both parties. And Jesus Christ, in his humanity, is us, and he represents us to his Father, but he's also the Son of God, and he represents God to us. The only way that God comes to us is through his Son, Jesus Christ, and the only way we get to God is through his Son, Jesus Christ. He is that connecting link. Well, where on earth was Jesus born? Oh, and I added, it's not where on earth was he born, it's where in the earth was he born. And in Micah 5:2, it tells us exactly where he was born, in Bethlehem. And the city is named. And you think, wow, couldn't the Old Testament, couldn't these students of the Old Testament figure this out? And the answer is, yes, they could. In fact, when the wise men showed up at Herod, he says to the scribes, where is the one to be born? And the scribes looked in their Bibles, their Old Testament, or they already knew it. And they told Herod, he's going to be born in Bethlehem. That's what the scripture says. Really? You knew that? Well, what are you doing in Jerusalem? Why aren't you in Bethlehem? That's a question you'll have to ask some of those people someday when you see them. And I hope we see some of them in heaven, and you can ask them, what was wrong in Israel at that particular time? And I might just say this, what's wrong with America at this particular time? Did you know that in the world today, still the most popular book is the Bible? In fact, somebody did a little research that if you added up all the number of Bibles in the United States and divided by the number of people, we have close between 4 and 5 Bibles per household. Think, wow, you talk about not having an excuse. Well, let's add this statistic to that. Ignorance of the Bible has never been greater. The more Bibles we have, the ignorance goes up. And explain that one. I guess sin natures haven't changed, have they? Where? Point number 4. We got that. And then how? How did it happen? Well, he came forth made of a woman, made under the law. So God sent forth his Son, born of a woman. And that's kind of interesting that he would say that. If I look at any one of you today, and I don't care what in sound politically correct, I don't care what the woke crowd says about childbirthing. If you were born, you came out of a female. And there isn't anyone here who doesn't have a mother. Does that make sense? Well, I just said it. You can shoot me later, I guess, or go to jail for that. But it's such an obvious fact, isn't it? Born of a woman. And yet, why is this included in the scripture? Well, it goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, when Adam and Eve sinned, and God is visiting with Adam and Eve and Satan. And he looks at Adam. Why'd you do this, Adam? And Adam says, it's that woman you gave me. She made me do it. Boy, we've been passing the buck ever since, haven't we? So not only did Adam blame his wife, he blamed God for giving him his wife, who led him astray. And so God looks at Eve and says, Eve, what's going on here? And Eve says, that snake made me do it. And God says, okay, snake. And he talks to Satan. And he says, I'm going to tell you something, Satan. A seed is coming. And a seed is coming from a woman. And you're going to bruise its heel, but that seed is going to crush your head. And I'll just say this. If God told you your head was going to be crushed by a seed that was born of a woman, I don't know about you, but if I were in Satan's shoes, I'd want to get rid of that seed that's going to crush my head. And ever since, Satan has been trying to figure out how to kill Jesus Christ. And he thought he had his victory at the cross when Jesus was bruised for us. But guess what? He lost. And the Bible clearly tells us that Satan is condemned forever when Jesus Christ was resurrected from the dead. And there is no chance, and Satan knows it, of ever killing the seed. The seed is there, and his name is Jesus Christ. And so what is Satan doing today? He is actively, we're told in 2 Corinthians, blinding people's eyes. He is trying to kill everything that God loves. You love your car, he's going to key it. You love your house, he's going to throw eggs at it or throw paint on it or something. He is going to mess up what you love if he hates you and he can't get to you. You know who God loves? He loves people. And Satan is out to destroy who God loves. And we can see it everywhere. People are being dehumanized. And the fact that we're born in God's image is totally ignored. Satan's doing his job, according to himself. But he was born of a woman. This was prophesied. This was prophesied in Genesis 3:15, in Isaiah 7:14. He's born of a virgin. And in Matthew 1:18-25, the angel shows up to Joseph and says, Joseph, I know this doesn't look good. I'm paraphrasing a little bit. And it didn't look good to Joseph. Joseph was thinking, you know what? My espoused wife is pregnant and I didn't do it. Doesn't look good. And God talked to Joseph and said, listen, Joseph, don't be afraid to take your wife as a wife, because the child in her is born of the Holy Spirit. This is God's child. And it's interesting, Joseph could have said, yeah, right. A lot of people today say that, yeah, right. In fact, many popular theories is that Nazareth was a place where Roman soldiers hung out, or they had a military base in Nazareth. And if you have ever been in the military, and I haven't, some of you have, soldiers, especially on their weekend passes, can be rather unruly. And the theory is that Mary cavorted with a Roman soldier and made up the whole story. And that's how Jesus was born. I want you to know, that is blasphemy. Joseph believed God, and he became Mary's husband and helped raise God's son. And we're told that's exactly what happened. We're also told that he was born under the law. And as we stop and we think of being born under the law, we'll take some time to look at the significance of that at another time. But the law was nailed to the cross. It was taken away when Jesus died. But in the meantime, Jesus was born under that law. And what we're told in Scripture is this: he fulfilled the law perfectly. Remember, the purpose of the law was to prove you were a sinner. How could a sinner pay for the sin of another sinner? You got your own sin to worry about. But Jesus Christ was not a sinner. And so being born under the law had significance because he is the only person who has kept the law perfectly. And you can read through the Gospels. He went to the feasts. He did everything he was supposed to do. He fulfilled the law, and nobody could accuse him otherwise. Well, we'll look at the sixth one. Why did he do it? And the answer is in verse 5. Let's read it. To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And what's interesting is this, is that it goes back to verse 1. Remember? When you're a child, you're under the tutors and you're under the governors. But they had ceremonies in those days when a kid became of age. The Jews had it, the Greeks had it, the Romans had it. And when the father decided that it was time for his son to be a mature adult, they'd have a party. Well, we have our little birthday parties today, but they had a party. And they celebrated the maturity of that son. And this is what Paul is saying, that we might receive the adoption of sons. We're going from a minor, M-I-N-O-R, not a minor, to a, if you're not a minor, you're of majority age, right? Okay? That's what they're celebrating. That's what Paul is talking about right here. Redeem means to buy out of or buy back. And in the Greek, there's differences of that. Redemption, buying back what formerly was yours. In fact, if you have a house, and there's different laws in the different states, but they're all pretty similar, and you quit making your mortgage payments, what's going to happen to it? Your mortgage will be foreclosed upon, and your house will be repossessed. But there's a law that says this: if your house is repossessed, and depending on which state you're in, I think it's 30 days in Minnesota, you have 30 days to go back and pay up the house, and it will not go up for sheriff's auction. Does that make sense? And that is called redemption. You have a chance to redeem your house, to buy it back. Well, we're told that we've been bought with a price, and we're not our own. Jesus Christ came and bought us out of the marketplace of sin, with his own blood. And I'll tell you what, that should have some real significance to us as we think of being bought and being not our own. This term was used when purchasing a slave in order to set them free. And there were Romans that did that. They would go into the marketplace, they would buy a slave, and then grant them their freedom. You say, wow, what a nice guy. Yeah. And they were redeemed. Jesus Christ paid the price to free us from the very penalty of sin. He redeemed us. In going through the book of Romans, we ran across three terms. And we need to pay attention to these terms. There's redemption. There's propitiation. There's reconciliation. And all three carry a different, how can I put it, meaning or application. You see, God, the Father, a holy God, can't take sin. His holiness was propitiated or satisfied at the cross. Sin needed to be paid for. Redemption is the term we apply to the payment of sin. And you know what it means? It means that we can be reconciled to God. And it might just say that God is never reconciled to us. We are the ones that are out of step. We need to be reconciled to God. And it's through the death of Christ that he does that. In closing, just let me review a couple of old pictures that I like. Here I am. Here's a holy and a just God. We're called the children of wrath. And because of that, God's wrath must be poured out on sin. This is not good news for me. You either, by the way. We're in a bad way. But God so loved the world. You know what he did? He did this. He became my substitute. And he died in my place. That's what Jesus Christ did for me. Is my sin paid for? Absolutely. And the holiness of God is going to be satisfied because he paid for sin. And when it comes to Christmas, this is what we should remember. And as we stop and we think of God giving us his son, and that's what we're celebrating now, many of you, including myself, we have little nativity scenes in the house. God gave us his son. What for? To pay for sin. And as a resurrected Savior, he's returned and is currently seated at the right hand of the Father. And God is 100% satisfied with the price that Jesus Christ paid. So that leaves a question for us. Are we 100% satisfied with the price that Jesus Christ paid? Let me make it just a little more personal right here. Put your name right here. God gave you his son. God's son paid for your sin. Did you know that? God is 100%. Since God is 100%, then let me ask you this. Are you 100% satisfied with the price that Jesus Christ paid for you? I hope you can say, with the Apostle Paul and what he said about Abraham, that he was fully persuaded that what God promised, God could deliver on. And that's the message behind Jesus Christ coming. He promised us a Savior. Do you believe that Jesus Christ can save? Are you fully persuaded in your mind that God can deliver on his promise? Let's close in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. We thank you that you love the world, and whosoever believes in you will not perish, but have everlasting life. We pray that we would take that to heart, and that we'd be fully persuaded that by God giving us his son, we can be given the gift of eternal life. We thank you for that great promise, and we just pray that this Christmas season, we would become more and more thankful for who you are and the great gift that you have given us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together and we'll sing the last verse of O Come All Ye Faithful.